First of all, we were talking about creativity. How is creativity and sleep connected?
They are very connected. We know that sleep inspires problem solving. It's almost as though sleep is like it's a group therapy for memories. That sleep gathers in all of the information that you've been learning during the day, and it starts to collide it in these strange connected ways. It's sort of informational alchemy, as it were, so that you wake up the next day with a revised mind-wide web of associations. And we can now demonstrate that in the laboratory. We can sort of give you these problems to solve that seem difficult before sleep, and then we give you a full 8 hours, and we measure your sleeping brainwaves. You wake up the next day, and you're 3 times more likely to be able to solve a problem than if you just to stay awake on a problem. And that's the reason that no one has ever told you to stay awake on a problem. Instead, they tell you to
sleep on a problem.
And what I find fascinating about that, in every language that I've inquired about to date, that phrase, sleeping on a problem, it seems to exist, you know, from French to Swahili. You know, we, the British, we say you sleep on a problem. I think the French translation is a little bit closer to you sleep with a problem.
I've done that many times.
Yeah, you know.
I can tell you that names.
I think it says so much about the difference between the British and the French. You know, British, we sleep on a problem. French, we sleep with a problem.
Yeah.
So be it.
This is the good side of sleep, but also, I mean, we do sleep less. I mean, 100 years ago, we slept a lot more, didn't we?
That's right, yeah. So a survey done back in 1942 demonstrated that the average adult was sleeping 7.9 hours a night. Now that number is closer to 6 hours and 30 minutes. So there's been this incredible erosion of sleep time throughout industrialized nations. It's happened across probably about the past 70 years. That's almost 20%. You know, it took Mother Nature 3.6 million years to put this necessity of 8 hours of sleep in place. And then within the space of an evolutionary blink of the eye, we've lopped off 20% of that time.
Many people try. They try to sleep, but either they can't fall asleep or they will wake up midnight. And I mean, at 4 in the morning and not be able to sleep again.
And those are classically the two forms of insomnia that we have. One is called sleep onset insomnia, difficulty falling asleep. The other is called sleep maintenance insomnia. So you can fall asleep, but you can't stay asleep. You wake back up. And certainly what we know is that one of the principal causes of insomnia, which, by the way, is twice as likely to be present in women than in men. It's a far more female impacted disorder. The principal cause there seems to be anxiety. That sort of fight or flight branch of the nervous system gets ramped up. And when that gets ramped up, it's very difficult to fall asleep. So what do you do about that? Well, there's lots of things you can try. Meditation has been demonstrated to be remarkably effective. It just sort of quietens down the nervous system, allows you to fall asleep. The other thing is actually a worry journal. Now, as a hard-nosed scientist, when I was looking at the evidence and reviewing this, I thought, it surely doesn't work, which is an hour before bed, just write down all of the concerns and the things that you have on your mind.
You do. It helps. I do that.
You do?
You do that?
Have a practice of, like, journaling out your...
I just write down all my ideas and everything I worry about, and also, in the sad times, everything I have to be happy about. And it really helps me fall asleep. It's really good. I do it.
Try to finish it with at least 3 things that are positive.
Yeah,
you know,
always.
3 good things about your day, or 3 things that you're grateful for. You already know it, which is great.
But it's another alternative, of course, is simpler. It's sleeping pills.
That would be true. Unfortunately, though, there are 3 problems with sleeping pills. Firstly, they are a class of drugs that we call the sedative hypnotics. And sedation is not sleep. But you mistake the former for the latter when you take these pills. Now, they just knock your cortex out. The other 2 issues is that sleeping pills have been associated with a significantly higher risk of death, as well as cancer, which is where you work with a therapist, and it's a psychological intervention, just as effective as sleeping pills in the short term. But what's great is that when you finish with your therapist, you keep that good sleep going. Whereas when you stop taking sleeping pills, you usually not only go back to the bad sleep that you are having, you often have what's called rebound insomnia, which is that your sleep gets even worse.
You're a fan of separate bedrooms.
Yeah, so I think for some people, the sleep divorce can prevent you from having a real one. We know that about 30 to 40% of people who are surveyed anonymously, by the way, will admit to not sleeping in the same bed. Of the remaining people who do go to bed and sleep or start trying to sleep in the same bed, they often wake up in a different bed. About 50% of those will wake up in a different bed. And what's, I think, interesting is that partners will often disrupt sleep. Males far more likely to snore and have a sleep disorder that we call sleep apnea. As I said, females twice the rates of insomnia. And that tossing and turning and that snoring can cause tension, it can cause poor sleep in one or both of the partners. And when you have a sleep divorce, essentially you start sleeping in separate bedrooms or you sleep in separate beds. Now, the stigma there is that if you're not sleeping together, then you're not sleeping together. But the opposite is true. What we know is that men who are not sleeping well will have a level of testosterone, which is that of someone 10 years their senior. So a lack of sleep will age a man by a decade. And for a woman, we also know that for every extra hour of sleep that she adds, there is a 13 to 15% increase in the desire to be physically intimate with her partner. So if you're getting good sleep...
I'm going to get some sleep.
is the message coming across here. So oddly enough, ironically, if you're sleeping well in separate bedrooms, your physical relationship tends to actually improve as
you
a
consequence. I'm interested in the idea of a sleep divorce because my husband snores a lot. He has sleep apnea. But I'm very aware that if we slept in different bedrooms, he would die. Because it's when you have sleep apnea, this is what happens. Which one your wife needs to save his life? Yes, I have to save his life. I have to wake up then I save his life. So if I was sleeping in another room, I would get a lot more sleep myself, but my husband would be dead. Like, kind of. Can you die of sleep apnea? Is basically what I'm asking. Well, can you die of snoring?
You can die of snoring, but you die chronically. Because the disrupted sleep will lead to an increased risk of things like diabetes, stroke, or cardiovascular disease.
I mean, he deserves it, to be honest.
I'm not going to rush to judgment on that, but clearly the sleep issues are causing you some anger problems that
we can talk about.
But, you know, in all seriousness, that sort of choking and the cessation of breath, that usually happens, you know, 5 to 10 times per hour.
A minute,
in fact. Now, if you were to say to someone, you know, I'm going to come into your room every night and maybe about 40 or 50 times throughout tonight, I'm going to strangle you to the point where you stop breathing. Is that okay?
You've had that thought too. Yeah. And,
you know, you would say, that's ridiculous. Yeah, that's terrible. No one would do that to me. Mm. But that's what the disorder of sleep apnea will do to someone. It's a horrifically serious disorder. So if you know someone who's snoring, please go and have them see a doctor. It is life-threatening. It will bring on and hasten the speed of many of those diseases that are killing us.
This is brilliant. I can just show him you saying that.
Exactly.
This is great. This is perfect.
Or you can bring him home and he can tell directly to your husband.
Yeah, come with me, yes.
Where do you live? I'll come and do a sleep intervention.
Is it a big difference between the quality... Or what is most important, the quality or the quantity of sleep?
We used to think it was quantity, and the advice we give is, you know, somewhere around 8 hours of sleep. And you asked me the question, you know, I certainly give myself a non-negotiable 8-hour sleep opportunity, not because I want to be a poster child or sort of, you know, practice what I preach. If you understood the importance of sleep, as I do, it's selfish. You would choose to do nothing other than give yourself that sleep. You know, I don't want disease or sickness. I don't want a shorter life. I want a longer life and a longer, healthier life. And it's the best insurance policy that I know of in terms of healthcare. So certainly quantity is important, but probably in the last 5 or 6 years, quality is also critical too. It's a combination of the two. So just because you may be in bed for 8 hours, if you're not getting that continuous sleep and the deep quality sleep first and then the sort of the dream sleep later in the night, you need all of these things to get those benefits.
I am in trouble.
Yeah, me too.
Wow.
Yeah.
I'm in deep shit.
I'm a desperately depressing guest, aren't I? Should I just... It's probably the reason I wear all black. It's the Johnny Cash look of the scientist.
But have you, I mean, you see a lot of politicians bragging about, I only need 4 hours of sleep, I only need 5 hours. Legendary politicians like
Margaret Thatcher.
Yep. Margaret Thatcher, Ronald Reagan. Yep.
Current head of state in America, you know, Donald Trump.
Yeah, yeah, they don't sleep much.
Oh, that's because he can't count. He's clearly sleeping long now. He's like, 4 hours. Doesn't count.
Yeah. Does it help with power naps then? Is that where power nap comes from?
Well, firstly, we know that the number of people who can survive on 7 hours of sleep or less without showing any impairment, rounded to a whole number and expressed as a percent of the population, is zero.
I see.
So anyone suggesting that they can survive on 5 or 4 hours of sleep is a fallacy. And, you know, it strikes me as interesting, one of the most significant lifestyle factors determining whether or not you will develop Alzheimer's disease is the amount of sleep that you're getting. Because at night, there is this remarkable cleansing system that kicks into high gear that washes away the toxic proteins that are linked to Alzheimer's disease. So you get this power cleanse at night. It's sort of good night, sleep clean. You know, technology is a problem. The image sort of issue, I think, is problematic. Caffeine, alcohol, those two are not the friends of sleep, it turns out.
Only caffeine in the morning, or...?
Yeah, so caffeine in the morning is OK, you know, a couple or two in the morning. But one of the problems with caffeine is that it has a half-life of about 6 hours and it has a quarter-life of 12 hours. What that means is that if you have a cup of coffee at noon, a quarter of that caffeine is still circulating in your brain at midnight. So if you have a cup of coffee, you know, around midday, it's the equivalent of getting into bed at night and before you turn the light out, you swig a quarter of a cup of coffee and you hope for a good night of sleep. It's just not going to happen.
And alcohol, is that also only in the morning?
Well, you know, it's strange, but alcohol is, again, a group of drugs that we call the sedatives. So, again, you're just knocking yourself out with the nightcap. Alcohol also litters your sleep with many more awakenings. It's called fragmented sleep. So you don't feel as restored by your sleep the next morning. And finally, alcohol is a very powerful drug at blocking your dream sleep. And so the advice that, you know, I would never give on a television program in front of a public audience would be, yes, you should go to the pub in the morning, and that way, by the evening, the alcohol is out your system, and you're just fine. But I would never say that as a professional, you know. Can we cut that? No, I'm kidding.
The thing is, they are not open.
Yeah, that's true.
One last thing I have to ask you, because we're 1 week away here in Europe now, from what we call summertime, or I think it's called daylight savings time.
That's right.
And then we change the day. You have it in America as well. I think you have it already.
That's right, yeah. And so...
Does that affect us?
It affects us markedly, and I think there's good reason to disabuse society of that impact. And you may think, you know, what's the harm of 1 hour of sleep? Well, I'll tell you this. In the spring, when we lose 1 hour of sleep, the next day we see a subsequent 24% increase in heart attacks, which is dramatic. And we see an equivalent rise in the risk of suicide, suicidal thoughts, suicidal attempts, suicide completion. We also see a spike in road traffic accidents that following day. This is all just 1 hour of lost sleep. This is how fragile and vulnerable our bodies are to even just the smallest perturbation of sleep. Now, in the autumn, in the fall, when we gain an hour of sleep, we see a beautiful 21% reduction in heart attacks. So it's bi-directional. Why are we doing this to society? We should maintain stability.
So we should take it away?
I think we should take it away.
I think we should too. Take it away now.
Yes. Thank you. Can we...
Yeah. It's actually something that is quite easy to do something about.
Yeah, it's really not that difficult, and the lives that it could save would be non-trivial.
You're gonna do a song called Animal. So please take the stage. Thank you so much, Aurora. And we know for sure that animals, they are quite good at this. They know how to sleep.
Well, human beings are the only species that deliberately deprives itself of sleep for no apparent reason. No other species throughout evolution has decided to take sleep away.
Matthew, thank you so much for being here tonight.
Thank you very much indeed.
And thank you.
Hope you enjoyed the clip. For more interesting conversations, please hit subscribe.